In this video, you're going to see multiple different options on how you can have dynamic scenes with updating the NavMesh at runtime without the huge stutter that comes from a full NavMesh rebake. We're going to be looking specifically at how I did this in the free and open source microgame Dino Attack, where I have one type of dino that should be able to run underneath the wall, that's the Velociraptor, but the T-Rex cannot path until that wall is destroyed. There's not a one-size-fits-all solution for this, but by the end of this video, you'll know which one to pick for your specific use case. Hey, Chris here from LlamAcademy, here to help you.
Who? Me?
Yes, you! Make your game dev dream become reality by diving deep into the navigation system. Before we just jump into the solutions, let's talk a little bit about how the navigation system works with some of these different components we're going to talk about to have the full context for which solution should you pick. Since around 2019, Unity's had this new navigation system. It's now available through the package manager, but it works more or less the same as it has for the last 6 years. We get a new high-level component called the NavMesh Surface, which allows us to bake a navigation mesh per agent type. This was a huge boon to Unity navigation because before you could only have one agent type baked, so all of your units kind of felt the same. Now we can have different nav meshes per agent type. So we can structure our levels where a Velociraptor can run under and a T-Rex has to knock down the building before it can pass through. When we click bake, we see the blue mesh in the scene. And as we bake more, we see more and more blue meshes in the scene. I'm not gonna go too deep into any of these components. I've covered all of them in depth before in the AI series. I'll have a link to that playlist in the description. But what the surface does is collects all of the objects in the scene or in a volume or in the hierarchy. You can control all of that on the surface and says, okay, I'm gonna collect all of these objects and then consider what's walkable, not walkable based on its configuration and which NavMesh modifiers and NavMesh modifier volumes are in that area it's trying to bake. The NavMesh modifier and the NavMesh modifier volume are used at bake time. They are not dynamically modifying the NavMesh at runtime. We can use the NavMesh obstacle to carve the NavMesh at runtime to dynamically, in real time, block agents from moving in different areas. And the last extremely important component is the NavMesh link, which allows us to define how agents can traverse from different disjoint NavMesh areas. This is commonly used for ladders or jumps or something like that, but you'll see later, this can also be used to help us get more dynamic runtime NavMeshes. There are four ways to approach this that I came up with, and we'll go through them in order of complexity. Number one is we just rebake the whole scene. That's what I actually initially launched Dino Attack with. And since it's a relatively small scene with relatively few objects on desktop with even medium hardware, it wasn't a big deal. However, as soon as we move this to a performance limited environment like WebGL or mobile, we experience really large stutters when we rebake the NavMesh. So in scenarios where you have really simple world geometry to rebake or really small scenes, and you're running with really powerful hardware, rebaking the whole scene is a viable option. You can do it. However, we will see in a lot of cases that this just doesn't work out because it takes too long and there's big stutters when it happens. The next one was, okay, let's just throw a NavMesh obstacle where the walls are or where we want to block and we can adjust it up and down. Then we don't need to rebake anything. We bake in the editor once per agent type and just block off the different areas. When the wall is active, the NavMesh obstacle is on the ground blocking the dino movement. But once the wall is destroyed, we just move it up to block the human movement and allow the dinos through. And that worked well until the Velociraptors came into play, because the NavMesh obstacle does not carve per agent type. The NavMesh obstacle carves the entire NavMesh, regardless of which agent types we're talking about. If in your game you have relatively few types, or you want all agents to treat this obstacle the same, using a NavMesh obstacle is a great option because it is extremely fast, it does not require a rebake, and it even updates a NavMesh when you want to calculate NavMesh triangulation. That triangulation considers the carved NavMesh from any obstacles, which is something I learned while I was trying to solve this problem. A third option is you can bake on a prefab a NavMesh. And this is really cool because if you do prefab replacement as part of, like, you have a built object and a destroyed object, if you're doing that type of a prefab replacement, if you align NavMesh links to the edge of that NavMesh, it will automatically connect, provided you position it properly, to the runtime NavMesh, and your agents will automatically say, hey, I know how to traverse this now, and start walking over that new area. That NavMesh data being stored per prefab allows you to very easily pre-bake everything in the editor, and then at runtime, there's very little to compute because you already have that area baked. I didn't end up going with that one, mostly because I didn't want to make a prefab variant for destroyed. But if you already have alive and destroyed variants, this is a great option for you that's extremely performant. It's just a little bit tedious to align your NavMesh links, but once it's there, it's very smooth. A fourth option is to bake a small area after the destruction or whatever event happens that you need to bake something new. Because the time complexity to bake a NavMesh scales up as we include larger areas and more objects, if we keep the bake really small with very few objects by using something like the collect objects volume, rebaking the NavMesh for a specific agent type can be very fast. Then, much like the previous option, you would just need to align some NavMesh links all around the edge wherever you'd like them to connect to, and the agents will automatically start traversing that path. This is a great option when we want to meld the existing world together with this area, including modifiers outside of this object. Unfortunately, with the last two options, I couldn't get it to just automatically meld with the existing NavMesh. It didn't quite work right. I needed the NavMesh links. That means you probably also want to have really good NavMesh link traversal. I covered in detail how you can make your very own link traversal types per area type, which ensures as the dinos traverse different NavMesh links with different types like jump or this just connection, you can configure it so they look really good. I'll have a link to that video in the description. And a fifth option is to use a combination of these, which is ultimately where I landed at. Either the third or the fourth option would work for dino attack. I was just a little bit lazy and didn't want to have to do all this extra prefab creation to have a destroyed variant and an alive variant, because it would have added additional complexity to other parts of the game I just didn't want to touch. So I went with option four, while also having NavMesh obstacles. That allowed me to reduce the number of different agent types I needed to rebake when a wall was destroyed. Right now we have the humans that can walk on top of the wall, and once it's destroyed, they shouldn't be able to do that anymore. While the building's alive, the velociraptors can run under, but the T-Rex and the Pachycephalosaurus should be blocked by it. Instead of doing all four rebakes, I said velociraptor's good enough. Because they're so fast and they prioritize attacking people, it's very unlikely that they're actually gonna be affected by the residual incorrect NavMesh areas. In this video, we've covered five different ways that you can approach updating your NavMesh at runtime with varying levels of complexity to implement, as well as the trade-offs of choosing each one of these. Armed with this information, you can choose the best one for your own game. Again, there's no silver bullet. Choose the one that fits your specific scenario the best. Sometimes easier is better. And if you want to learn more about the Unity navigation system, I've got the AI series playlist with over 50 videos detailing how you can do all kinds of different stuff with the Unity navigation system and enemy game AI, not generative AI. I've got something really exciting planned for August 26th at 7 a.m. Central US time. I'm gonna be hosting a live stream where I'm gonna be using the navigation package to walk through some different scenarios that you might need in your own game. So mark your calendar, August 26th, 7 a.m. Central US time. I hope to see you there. It's free for everybody. Becoming a YouTube member or Patreon supporter is an excellent way for you to show your support for this channel. Other ways you can show your support are you can get yourself some LlamAcademy merch right here on YouTube. You can use the affiliate links down in the description to purchase the Dino Pack or the Ultimate Pack from polyperfect, who provided all the assets you saw in this video for free for the full project on GitHub. They're under an educational use only license, which means if you want to use them in your own commercial project, you do have to purchase them, and using the links in the description are a great way to show your support for polyperfect and this channel. You could also check out my Unity real-time strategy course worth over 25 hours of video content, where you'll learn how to make your very own real-time strategy game. If you do choose to become a YouTube member or Patreon supporter, you'll also get your name up here on the screen at the end of every video and in every GitHub repository that comes out, as long as you're a supporter. You get access to a private members exclusive Discord, and starting at the awesome tier, you'll get a shout out at the end of every video like these awesome folks: Ivan, Ifiobolus, Jason Hansen, Sneddon, Trey Briggs, Will B, Mustafa, Nick5454, and Pixel Wizards. And there's also all of these great supporters as well. Thank you all for your support, and I'll see you on the next video.